Hi, this is Simon. This is part, I don't know, six of our introduction to pure data. In this video, we're going to continue talking about audio and discuss a couple different ways to play samples. To start with, it's going to be important where I keep these files. What I've done is I've created a folder here where I've put this PD patch as well as three sample files, a hi-hat, a kick, and a snare. There are ways to get pure data to access files in different folders, but we'll just keep it simple today. The object that I want to use is readsf, and this is going to end with a tilde because it's an audio object. Let's take this readsf and let's run it into our DAC so we can hear what's happening. And then let's open up the help file to have a look. What we're going to need to do is we're going to need to open the file and then play it. So there are two different messages that I need to send to this, the open command and then the playback. So let's start. We'll put down a message box, command 2, open, and I believe I've just called that hi-hat, and it's an AFE file. Case matters, uppercase and lowercase, and it's important that if this is an AIFF extension, we would have that second F. So we can just quickly double check. That looks good to me. Let's run this in. Now, if I click on that, nothing happens yet because I haven't played it. Command 2, I'm going to put a message box that just has a 1 in it. There we go. If I click it again, it's not playing. And actually, I'm getting an error message saying that I haven't sent the open yet. So if I click this again, then this, I can make that hi-hat trigger again. So what I might do is just make it so I only have to click in one place by creating a bang. Let's try it. Works pretty well. So in that folder, I have three audio files. I have the hi-hat, the kick, and the snare. So I can take this, Command-D to duplicate it. Again, snare with a capital S. Run these both in here. Now we try. Sounds good. Command-D to duplicate it again. Kick. That's pretty great. And of course, it would be very simple for me to just go to a patch that we already made, for example, like in our lesson 3, paste this over. Now I can make a drum sequencer that's playing these out. We go back to the help file on this. It's worth noting that we're sending ones to start the playback, and we're not sending anything to stop it because we have very short samples. If you have a longer sample, it could be worthwhile to be able to control the starts and stops of that. ReadSF reads sound files from your hard disk to play back, but we could also work with the computer's memory by using buffers. Let's talk to this patch I showed at the beginning of the video. First, we have an audio input coming in that goes to this throw, left, and right. These throws and their matching catches are just ways to send audio. It's a way to send multiple audio sources to one place. It's actually very useful. And so you'll notice I have other throws here. These all will get sent to here and mixed and sent to the left and the right. So this is just the direct sound coming in and going out. Here, this is just a VU meter for monitoring. They're under up here under put, VU meter. This envelope gets the envelope of an audio signal, subtract 100 from that, and that'll give you a real-time signal. I have my DSP stopped, that's why that's not moving right now. Next, though, the audio also goes into this tab write. So what this is doing is this is writing the audio coming into it to an array. You can create an array by going put array, then it allows you to provide some information for the array. I've called my array looping buffer. That's a name that I decided, and it's relatively arbitrary, but it's a useful name for it. So this is writing to this looping buffer. The looping buffer is over here. If I go to the properties of this buffer, I can see that, okay, there's the name of it, looping buffer, and the size, 441,000 points. Again, this is an array, so it's just a list of numbers. In this case, it's a list of 441,000 numbers. Why did I choose that number? Well, I know that the sample rate that I have set in PD is 44.1. If I go up to Preferences Audio, I can see here my sample rate is set to 44.1 kilohertz. That means 1 second of audio is represented by 44,100 samples. So by having 441,000 samples in my looping buffer, I've created a 10-second buffer. So what happens is this tab write is going to start recording to that buffer when it receives a bang. If I go to the help here, we can see that a bang starts recording to this buffer. In the help example, they've called it array 99. Here's their array 99. In mine, I have this looping buffer, and I send a bang there. What's triggering these bangs, though, is my metro that I've set to be, surprise, surprise, about 10 seconds. I added a little bit here because I found it helps with pops. Retriggering it right at 10 seconds tended to cause some pops. Then above this, all I have is I have a load bang, which starts recording that buffer immediately when I open the patch. So now, if I go to my PD window, let's start the DSP. And now we can see audio is coming in here. Let's start this buffer recording again. So if I keep talking, now it's probably recording through the buffer, and this will update once it gets through the end of the buffer, and we'll see what happens. There it is. There is my talking right there. So far, so good. We have a way that we're recording to that buffer, and we're recording 10 seconds of audio to that buffer. Now, we're recording 10 seconds of audio to that buffer, but here's what we're doing to play it back. Once again, I have a load bang that starts this metro at the start every 100 milliseconds. This is our little counter construct. I've set my counter to be modulo 5, so it's counting 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. I have a select that's selecting through those. So let's watch. Unsurprisingly, now every 100 milliseconds, we're cycling through our select there. So what happens once we send a trigger out here? The meat of this is this tab play. Tab write up here writes to the buffer. Tab play here is going to play from the buffer. Now, let's look at this help file. The argument that I'm sending it is a set of two numbers here. The first number is going to be the start time that I play from that buffer, and the second number is how many numbers I take out of that buffer. So in this case, I'm choosing a random number for the start time. I'm choosing a random number between 0 and 418,950. That is not an arbitrary number. That's a weird number. But what I did was I took the whole length of the buffer, which is 441,000, and I subtracted how long a segment I wanted to play. In this case, I wanted to play for 0.5 seconds. If it's 0.5 seconds, and I have a sample rate of 44,100, then I divide 44,100 by 2, or multiply it by 0.5, to get the length here. And then I took this 2250 and subtracted it from the length of the buffer there. So I'm choosing a random number between the very beginning of the file and 0.5 seconds from the end of the file. So it's going to choose random spots along that buffer. Then the second number, as we said, is how long it's going to play it for, in this case, half a second. And we pass those arguments to the tab play. This 0.5 is just a little bit of attenuation, so it's not too loud. Again, multiply tilde 0.5. And then I have one more thing here. I have a V line. What this is doing is it's giving a little fade in and a little fade out. So V line starts at 0. It takes 250 milliseconds to get to 1. And then at the 250 millisecond mark, it starts a 250 millisecond fade out to 0. What's challenging here is we're working with both milliseconds and samples. So let's think about this. Our metro, our unit is milliseconds. This metro here, our unit is milliseconds. This V line, our unit is milliseconds. But everything that we're reading and writing from the buffer is in samples. So we need to keep track of that and be able to do that math. Again, it can end up with some ugly numbers, but the good news is we don't have to keep these numbers in our head. We can put them down in the patch. We can write a comment about how we arrived at that numbers. And so the computer does the hard work for us. So this provides a little fade in and fade out across 0.5 seconds. And then this first one, I throw it to the left and the right. The second one, I just throw to the left, right, left, right. And this gives us a kind of stereo live granulation of sound. All right, so I can't hear this because otherwise, because of my recording setup, things it would just feed back on itself. So I've muted the output of Pure Data, but I'm assuming that this is applying all sorts of neat effects to my voice. My voice comes in here, gets thrown to the left and right, and we can see it being caught over here. It's always nice to have some sort of input monitoring. It makes it easier to troubleshoot your patch, and you can always be sure that you're seeing the audio come in if you're using live processing. Then here, I write to the buffer. If we watch carefully here, we could see it re-trigger every 10 milliseconds. There it goes. And so then this buffer is written. And then here, we're reading from this buffer as we count through. We're doing 5 different grains, all 5 milliseconds. I'm sorry, 0.5 seconds, 500 milliseconds. 5 seconds, and they're played in succession here. Pretty neat.